This podcast is brought to you by WRFL, Radio Free Lexington. Find us online at WRFL.fm. Catch us on your FM radio while you're in Central Kentucky at 88.1 FM all the way to the left. Thank you for listening, and please be sure to subscribe.
Welcome to Philosophy Bakes Bread, food for thought about life and leadership.
Philosophy Bakes Bread is a production of the Society of Philosophers in America, a.k.a. SOPHIA. I'm Dr. Eric Thomas Weber.
And I'm Dr. Anthony Cashio. A famous phrase says that philosophy bakes no bread, that it's not practical. But we, in SOPHIA and on this show, aim to correct that misperception.
Philosophy Bakes Bread airs on WRFL Lexington 88.1 FM and is distributed as a podcast next. Listeners can find us online at philosophybakesbread.com, and we hope you'll reach out to us on Twitter at philosophybb, on Facebook at philosophybakesbread, or by email at philosophybakesbread@gmail.com.
Last but not least, you can always reach us and leave us a short recorded message with a question or comment or that sweet, sweet, bountiful praise. So much bounty that we may be able to play on the show, and we often do. So we really love hearing from you guys. You can reach us at 859-257-1849. That's 859-257-1849. On today's show, we're very excited to talk with Daniel Flores. Welcome to the show, Dan. I'm really glad you can join us.
Hey, thanks. Good to be here. Appreciate the invitation.
Yeah, so glad you could join us.
Yeah, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thank you.
Today's topic is about difficulties following the golden rule. Everyone knows the golden rule. Apparently, it's not so golden. Well, we'll see. We'll talk about it. in fact, that's the title of an essay written by Dan, The Not-So-Golden Rule, that was published in Philosophy Now magazine. Dan is a professor of philosophy and also the director of the Northwest Honors College at Houston Community College.
That's right. Daniel's interests are within the realm of metaphysics and philosophy of science, especially causation and explanation, also philosophy of religion and logic. Daniel has a passion for teaching logic in particular. Daniel is also involved in the New Mexico, Texas Philosophical Society, having served as the society's president, secretary, and editor-in-chief of the Society's peer-reviewed journal, Southwest Philosophical Studies.
Finally, Dan has also published some philosophical literature, Correlation and Conclusion, Neuroscience and the Belief in God, and Plato's Euthyphro, Philosophers and Uncertainty. Does that sound all good to you, Dan? I'm going to set an aside here.
It sounds different when it's read to me rather than looking over, say, my CV or something. That's great.
All right, well, Dan, yeah. You've listened to this show before, so you know that we begin with a first segment we call Know Thyself. We happen to think that it's very important for philosophers to know themselves, and that's part of the larger philosophical project. So we want you to tell us about yourself, about your background, about how you got into philosophy, right? So
right.
A little pop quiz here. Who are you? Who is Daniel Flores? Tell us about yourself.
It's a hell of a pop quiz. Who am I? A, B, C, or D, right? Well, let's see. Yeah. So I guess some relevant facts, you know, I grew up with a fairly religious background in Catholicism. And alongside that, I guess I was always sort of a questioning type person. I was the child who would never take a straight answer. Like, I know, but why? I know, but why? And, you know, the religion and stuff was a very important part of my life. I think at one point I was aspiring to be a priest or something like that, if I remember correctly.
Really?
Nice.
Yeah, it was a long time ago.
You don't remember if you were trying to become a priest, clearly?
Well, I remember I didn't take steps to actually do it. I was too young. I was about 14, 15 when I was sort of at the height of my religious thinking, I suppose. I always knew I wanted to go to school. That was very important to us. We grew up with a library in our house. And even though our parents had sort of just a couple of semesters each of college, we still grew up in a very literate family. Dad would read us Beowulf and the Iliad for our bedtime stories. Mom would read us the Golden Book series and so on. And so we had a fairly challenging, I think, intellectual upbringing. So
where,
I got to college.
Where was it that you grew up? I'm sorry.
Well, my birth town is Odessa, Texas, and what I call my hometown El Paso, Texas. That's where sort of I went from adolescence to adulthood, and that's where I had most of my most relevant experiences.
Dan, you don't sound like you're from Texas. I thought you're supposed to talk like this.
You know, I get that a lot, actually.
From Texas,
a lot of people
please
have
ignore Eric.
Yeah, for some reason people have trouble placing me. That's not the only time I've heard that.
I get that. Alabama.
So, you know, I started off as a music theory composition major.
Oh.
And yeah, so I've been on stage, you know, half of my life, and I do miss that. Then, you know, like most people, there were problems, family problems, you know, divorce and, you know, between the parents. And I was trying to work full time, trying to go to school. I had a rough time of things, and I ended up staying out of school for about 2 years. And I came back, and in order to get my financial aid back, I had to take something like 9 hours on my own. And I'd always heard of, you know, philosophy. I had no idea what it was. It was mentioned to me by a fellow student, I think, in the symphony. And so I took it, and I took a British literature class, and I was a drummer in a blues band.
Huh.
And yeah, and I realized two things that semester, about midway through the semester. I was on the last page of Beowulf for the British literature class. And, you know, I know that story, and it'd be like the third time I'd read it at this point. And I realized I couldn't teach this. This is something that I couldn't just do. And I realized with the philosophy class how excited I was. And, you know, here's this sort of religious, you know, young man, and I'm reading things like Bertrand Russell's Why I'm Not a Christian, Ramakrishna's Many Paths to the Same Summit. There was this piece, I don't know who it was by, but he was asking the question, is it art? And he told this story about some artist who could hand draw a dollar, and if it was not recognizable, you know, at first appearance, then is it really a dollar or is it art and so on? And I remember thinking all this stuff and being terrified and excited all at the same time. I remember particularly, yeah, reading the Ramakrishna and Russell pieces, distinctly feeling like I shouldn't be reading this. Like you know, it was just this overwhelming, like religious feeling I had, like I'm doing something wrong by reading this, and I felt
there's a reason they call it the devil's advocate, right?
Exactly. Yeah. it was very scary, and I think, and you know, after I've been, gosh, I guess 13 years in the classroom now, and I get that a lot from students. They have similar reactions, so I'm sort of happy to tell this story and broadcast it to the public. I also remember that here's a discipline that has a vocabulary that has a that is dedicated to these sorts of questions. And as I told you earlier, I was always the brother who said, you know, I know, but why? I know, but why? I know, but why? It was never good enough. And here's a discipline that not only, you know, lets you ask these questions, but also encourages you to ask these questions. There's a vocabulary for it. And I suppose in the back of my mind somewhere, the idea that, you know, possibly make some money off of it.
Wait, so they pay me to ask these questions?
I'm sorry that you had to be disappointed about that expectation.
Yeah. Hey, I got a decent place to live. I got a nice car. Hey, so
fair enough. No, I'm just teasing. You're absolutely right.
So I think to answer part of your question, then the draw to philosophy was it ended up being therapeutic to me. It ended up, my old boss used to say, philosophy is good for the soul. And I can only imagine what he sort of meant by that. But it helped me, I think, deal with the world by being able to organize it and realize which questions were important, which weren't. You know, I don't want to anticipate anything later in the show, but I found philosophy to be very useful. And well, I think
that's okay. We happen to think that as well.
Yeah, I would hope so.
And motifs that return in music are wonderful, right?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And I think there's a very strong sort of musical connection. I've unfortunately lost my sense of poetry and metaphor, I think.
Oh no. What do you mean? Do you see any connection between sort of your early music theory training and sort of your drawing
and
philosophy?
Yeah, absolutely. I think music is all about patterns. Music is about recognition of patterns and being able to express ideas and thoughts. And in that sense, I think philosophy is incredibly musical. Philosophy teaches us, among other things, to recognize patterns, various patterns, logical patterns, patterns of argument, patterns in storytelling, you know, how to, say, write an article or even read an article. And there's the rhetorical component of the spoken and written word, I think. I think philosophy is incredibly musical. And I dare say I wouldn't be the philosopher I am without that musical background.
Very cool.
I really like that a lot.
Yeah.
Further plug here. I mean, if you know anything about music theory and you've studied music theory and you look at logic, symbolic logic, you know, first order propositional logic and so on, there's a pretty strong connection in the symbolism and interpretation of symbols and so on.
That's an interesting thought. Well, so we ask a question that we believe to be pretty important in every first segment of this show. I think Anthony should ask it.
Oh, I always love asking this question. Dan?
Yes.
What is philosophy to you?
How much time do we have?
About 3 minutes. No, about 3 minutes.
Well, I really liked what you were saying about philosophy looking for patterns and recognizing that. So I thought that's
So I think we look for patterns in ways that other disciplines don't. So I will say this. So I do think it's a mistake to give a definition of philosophy.
Aha. That's a new answer.
That's good.
And so, you know, I automatically revert to, you know, what sort of Descartes' line of questioning, I think, in his first meditation, where, you know, he asks, what is man? He says, well, a rational animal. Then you have to ask, what is rational and what is man? And I think the same thing happens when you start defining philosophy. You know, if you start with sort of the breakdown of the word, you know, philos and sophia, then you have to do this sort of taxonomy of these words and meanings.
And those mean?
Philos and Sophia, so love and wisdom.
There you go.
So oftentimes in particularly introductory courses, you know, one way I think we try to grab students, I don't do this, but I think a lot of people do, is they'll say, you know, philosophy is the love of wisdom. And I find that odd, I guess.
Oh, yeah? Why?
You know, my dentist probably loves wisdom, you know, and I
hope he does.
You know, there's an obvious joke.
How about wisdom teeth?
Yeah. Exactly. But so, was that bad? All right, that was bad.
No, that's good.
So I think characterizing someone as a lover of wisdom doesn't necessarily say a whole lot. So you might love wisdom and not do anything about it. Or you might strive for wisdom without knowing what to strive for. And I'm not sure the love of wisdom does us any good. And with similar definitions, so this is what I'll say. There's two things. I like to characterize philosophy rather than define it. And the way I characterize it is generally through William James. I'm not a pragmatist, although I've taken several seminars on pragmatism myself. But so James says that philosophy is the unusually stubborn attempt at trying to think clearly.
Uh-huh.
And I find that fairly accurate.
Nice.
If philosophy is about anything, it's about trying to think through ideas and concepts, and trying to be as careful as we can about what our claims are and how we get to those claims. And I'm not saying other disciplines don't do this, but I think particularly as someone comes from a sort of analytical tradition, I think our concepts are important, and it's important to try to get at what these concepts mean in a way where we try to avoid, you know, bias and some of our cognitive difficulties we have, and present an idea that is believable.
Very nice. Well, we are unfortunately out of time for this segment, Dan, but thank you so much for being with us. Everybody, we've been talking with Dan Flores. This is Eric Weber. My co-host is Anthony Cashio, and you're listening to Philosophy Bakes Bread. We'll be right back after a short break.
Welcome back to Philosophy Bakes Bread. This is Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber here talking today with Daniel Flores about the not-so-golden rule. So in this second segment, we'll ask Dan about the everyday sense of the golden rule as well as the challenges Dan sees for it. In the next segment, we'll hear more about a sort of scholarly approach to the golden rule as well as Dan's critique of that formulation. He's got critiques all over the place. So why don't we get right into it, Dan? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. This seems like one of the simplest and clearest explanations of ethical behavior, and yet you say it is conceptually flawed. I find this to be quite the claim. So can you lay out a brief critique for us? You know, what is the everyday sense of the golden rule? Why is it problematic? What is wrong with treating other people the way I would want to be treated?
Right. And, you know, that's a fairly common response. And there's other responses like, you know, why am I even talking about it and so on. I think
we'll get to my article.
Yeah. In my article, I have the quote from Neil Duxbury. He says, "The golden rule is a routine principle of action. A rule usefully serves as an interpretive tactic, like counting to 10 and so on. But it's practiced unreflectively." And this is sort of my initial approach to things like this. This seems more like a platitude than anything. A couple of weeks ago, Marriott Commercials actually came out with a commercial. I've only seen it once, but they're pushing the golden rule. It's national TV, and they're, you know, trying to sell rooms. And they're saying, you know, wouldn't it be nice if we all practice the golden rule? And they sort of say how they practice it. And my initial reaction is like, no, it wouldn't be nice. Like you would abhor living in a world where everyone practiced the golden rule.
Well, Dan, could you explain for Anthony sort of mentioned it, but could you, you know, tell us what it is exactly and what it mean, what it's intended to mean sort of in the very general sense?
Yeah. So it comes in many forms. As it was said in the beginning, you know, treat others as you want it to be treated. It, in other forms, love thy neighbor as thyself, so on. And generally speaking, this is, as it's sort of understood by the folk, if you will, sort of the, you know, generally educated people, so on, this sort of a rule of morality that at the very least invokes sort of the spirit of morality and how we should treat each other. And assumptions being that if we want to be treated well, then if we treat people the way we want to be treated, then we would treat them well, they would treat us well. It's often touted as being easily done. You just imagine yourself in the place of your neighbor. And, you know, and it's interesting, right? Because if you take children, for example, children, you know, I've told this to children before and they seem to get it. And, you know, oftentimes they'll stop their behavior because they realize if someone did that to them, they wouldn't like it very much, you know?
Exactly.
You know, they're, you know, some little boy is poking a little girl with a stick and you say, you know, now, Johnny, would you want her to do that to you? And like, no, and then they'll stop. There's a certain force to it. It seems to make some sort of sense and some sort of ethical sense. It's old. It's been around, you know, forever. It's in some of the older parts of the Bible. We find it in lots of other cultures, Nigerian proverbs and so on. It's ancient and it seems to be something codified. Everyone knows it when you talk to them. And it's hard to combat that.
You lay out a pretty good case for it. Why would you want to combat it?
Yeah, why do we need to combat it? Exactly.
Yeah, so if you go back to that Marriott commercial, like, I mean, would you really want to live in a world where everyone is treating everyone else the way that they want to be treated? The assumption here is that we all want to be treated well, and we all have an understanding of what being treated well means. And one thing I try to point out in my piece, and, you know, others have done before, some of us have what people might call defective desires, or even if they're not defective, I might have perfectly morally consistent desires. You might have perfectly morally consistent desires, but that doesn't mean that those desires compete with each other. They're not necessarily concomitant with each other.
What do you mean by morally consistent desire?
Right. So I might have a belief system that is moral belief system that's consistent, so there's no contradictions. And I might very well be acting, let's say, ideally morally. And someone else might have a similar system, but those two might be incompatible with each other. You know, Kant comes to mind here, for example. I suppose, you know, in Kant's system, you know, you can justify presumably going to war, you can justify not killing innocent people. And if you have two people who hold those beliefs, they're consistent in Kant's system, and yet those two beliefs seem to be contradictory to each other. Right. Just as maybe an example.
In other words, because when you go to war, there's always collateral damage. Is that what you mean?
There isn't necessarily collateral damage, but there's the possibility of innocent people being killed. Right. Mm. And so So the golden rule, just it you go into it with the assumption that we all have similar desires and that we understand what those desires are. And frankly, if you ask me, that it's sort of already question begging, right? It's already assumed that those desires are good and normal and so on. And you know, all you have to do is look at your neighbor and ask if you would want to live your neighbor's life. And you know, probably not. I think that's very telling for moral thinking.
Mm-hmm. So, Dan, I think you've sort of set up one of the, you know, premises of a question I have for you, which is that, as you say, we use the golden rule to teach children things, for instance, and sometimes to teach ourselves, right? So
yes.
I have a 4-year-old son, and he, you know, was doing X and Y, for instance, calling people names. And I asked him how he would feel if people called him this and that, and mm-hmm. and sort of it's as you say, an instructive tool. It sort of teaches you about the effect of what you're doing on others when you think about, you know, how it would feel to the recipient of that kind of behavior. And so basically, you know, I appreciate that there could be some sort of conflicts regarding war. What would be a more kind of everyday or mundane or personal example of a problem? What's wrongheaded, I guess? An example that shows how it's wrongheaded to make use of this golden rule as an instructive tool.
Right. So I think it would depend, you know, how seriously we're going to take it. So if we're going to use it, so I think there's something to it, right? So we can use a golden rule as sort of a sticky note on the refrigerator of our mind that says, you know, be moral, right?
Be good.
So, be good, be moral, whatever. And in that sense, I think the golden rule, I think that's probably the only merit, certainly from a theoretical standpoint, but from a moral standpoint that it has. And so fine, I mean, I'll take what I can get, right?
Okay.
But if we're actually going to teach the golden rule, as in you need to follow the golden rule, then the problems come the moment that other people have a different desire than you do. So take myself, for example, I tend to be, people who know me very well know this about me, I tend to be fairly honest. Brutally honest, people will say sometimes. And painful I like ones. It when people are like that to me. Mm. I don't, you know, there's certain social situations.
Great example.
And so I find when I am that way to other people, oftentimes, most often, they are not very responsive positively to me being honest. And yet that's how I want people to treat me. I've also found that a lot of people just do not want to be that honest with me. And, you know, whatever the reasons vary, you know, they don't want to hurt my feelings, or they might be wrong or embarrassed or something. And yet, if I'm practicing the golden rule, then I can hardly expect other people to do that to me, even though I'm treating them the way I want to be treated.
That's a fantastic example. It's the do I look fat in this question?
Yeah. And we're talking about honesty, right?
When I ask it.
About to look here. Exactly. Do I look fat in this? And, you know, I mean, yes.
That's a terrific example.
And so we have to be sort of careful. And the fact is that our social situations and contexts are way more nuanced than anything the golden rule can actually capture, the way we really live our lives. And so one of my sort of critiques of the golden rule is, you know, it doesn't sort of really do anything. The default position. So when I follow the golden rule and I end up doing something wrong, right, then we immediately say things like, oh, well, you know, clearly acting out of line, or that's not what the golden rule says, or, you know, he has defective desires and so on. Well, then if the default position to morality are ordinary moral principles, then what's the golden rule for? Mm. You know, and I say at best to remind us to be moral, but it doesn't really latch on to anything, I don't think.
I got another question. I mean, I could follow up to that. So sure. Should I be wary of teaching my children the golden rule? Like, I teach it to them. It seems like you're right. It's a nice sort of sticky note, but it's a good way to get it, right? You say, stop poking this kid, because would you want to be poked with a stick? And maybe poke it with a stick to remind them. That's not fun. You don't like that. I don't poke my children with sticks. I should be very clear about that.
Yeah.
Take
the candy away from them.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, if that's not the way to do it, and it's sort of a time honored tradition, and you're right about that, what kind of moral education do you recommend for the very young?
Right. So, I think the golden rule has a place, and in a larger project, I think the golden rule does remind us about morality. And in that sense, like I said earlier, I mean, I'll take what I can get. So as far as children go, look, I don't necessarily see a problem with saying, look, you know, don't do that to someone. You know, would you like it done to you? Because it is part of how we do live our lives. I mean, okay. I have to be like, I can't live my life the way I live it without students that, or the two of you either. Right. That's just a fact of who we are as say professors and educators, mm-hmm. which means I have to be cognizant of how I treat my students and, you know, people around me who I depend on to live my life.
Right. They tend to complain.
There's, and I complain and my neighbors complain and we also have good things to say. And so I think insofar as the golden rule has any merit, then that reminder of who we are, I think, carries some weight. And when you look at, you know, all the literature on the golden rule, if you look at the IEP article on the golden rule,
the Internet
Encyclopedia of Philosophy. Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Who wrote that? I think that was
the great website, by the way. Yes.
Bill Pulka, I believe, or Polk, I'm sorry, Bill Polk, I think is his name, if I remember right. You know, a lot of people remind us that the golden rule asks us to think about other people, and it asks us to consider sort of a egalitarian type of position. Even back as far as 1934, a philosopher named E.W. Hirsch, I believe, reminds us that what the golden rule is pushing is similarity and equality. But my point is that we have to remember all this stuff, because in the golden rule itself the golden rule says nothing about this stuff. We have to import this stuff into the golden rule. And I think once we start doing that, then we're doing something else.
That's very helpful. And we've got to wrap up this section, but I think one thing just worth pointing out that's really great in Dan's article, everybody, is the fact that he points to an author, one of these sort of leadership gurus, and we'll have the link to Dan's article in the show notes for today, for this episode. There's a leadership guru who tells you don't need anything else to understand ethics. And a lot of people listen to this guy, and he says the only thing you need to understand ethics is the golden rule. So I think Dan does a really wonderful takedown of that pretty simple argument, which shows how limited it is. So we're going to hear more about that, but actually we're going to ask Dan about a really tougher challenge, not the sort of shallow leadership guru, but an intellectual and scholar who's written on this subject. After a short break, this is Eric Weber. My co-host is Anthony Cashio. You're listening to Philosophy Bakes Bread, and we've been talking with Dan Flores. We'll be right back.
If you're hearing this, that means podcast advertising works. WRFL is now accepting new applications for advertising in a selection of our original podcast series. If you or someone you know owns a business in Central Kentucky and would be interested in advertising on WRFL's original podcasts, please email development@wrfl.fm.
Welcome back, everyone, to Philosophy Bakes Bread. This is Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber, and today we're talking with Dan Flores about the not-so-golden rule. And the last segment, we talked about the everyday sense of the golden rule. We poked Dan with our philosophical sticks. He poked us back because that's what we wanted.
How else can we learn, Anthony?
How else? So now you got to poke something with a stick. So in this segment, or a ruler, right? Catholic school. So in this segment, we're going to keep the conversation going, but we're actually going to focus on a lot more scholarly argument in favor of the golden rule, which Dan also has challenges to in his essay titled "The Not So Golden Rule," which appeared in the Philosophy Now magazine recently. Dan, one question we didn't get to last time, and I think it's actually kind of important: why take on the golden rule? Right? What is gained by a critique of this sort of really a kind of ethically important idea?
Yeah, I think some clarity in morality, for example. But I think it goes back to sort of why I would take on any of this. And my approach here generally is really a broader question about the role that philosophers in particular should play in the public sphere. in politics and government, nice. In education and so on.
Very nice.
And I did, you know, it's a fairly pointed article, I suppose, but the motivation comes from the fact that, you know, people believe these things. And if you take someone like Maxwell, for example, who I'm kind of railing against, you can spend thousands of dollars for tickets.
Maxwell is the motivational speaker.
The motivational speaker.
John C. Maxwell.
Yeah. And I don't, you know, I got to be careful here. I'm not saying he's necessarily doing this on purpose. I believe he's a pretty sincere person, everything, you know, from what I know about him. But if you look at sort of these motivational speakers and the things that they tell the crowds, if you look at advertising and politicians and the things they, it becomes difficult for the average person and even for trained professionals to sort of sort through things. And so when you're told that you can do the impossible or you can make the intangible tangible and so on, it sounds really great and it's powerful. And, you know, we're humans and we're rhetorical creatures and there's no escaping that, but we have to have some sort of tools for this. And I think philosophers just traditionally and historically are the ones that are trained to do this. And, you know, we're educators. And so I point back to the Marriott commercial at the Golden Rule.
I mean,
this is big. Yeah, right. This is big business. There's a Golden Rule Society, of which Gensler at least was a part of. I'm assuming he still
is. Wait, hold on. There's a Golden Rule Society, like a formal thing you can join?
Yeah, exactly.
I did not know that.
And we're talking about, you know, Harry Gensler, the scholar,
Harry,
right?
Harry Gensler, the philosopher. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, my thing is when we look at, here's the Golden Rule, something we're all familiar with. And if we're educators, we sort of know we need that hook. We need something that people are going to be, we need to identify. And what's more recognizable than the Golden Rule?
Yeah.
And so you start showing people and I think what the other thing I tried to do in the article is write in a fairly plain, uncumbersome language, except for maybe one paragraph in there on identity. And to have the average reader, say in philosophy now as a general educated readership, to see that if you take a step back and look at some of what you're actually being asked to believe, then with a little bit of philosophical insight, we'll come to the conclusion that, yeah, at least some of the things we're being asked to believe, we ought to just put on that shelf of I don't know, right? Like I'm gonna suspend my belief for a second, because can I really make the intangible tangible? I mean, does that make any sense to us? And so I think the answer is no. And so that's sort of the motivation for this.
Nice.
If that makes any
sense. It really does.
No, it's good.
In your article, Dan, you talk about a guy named Harry Gensler, whom we've just mentioned, and explain that he gives a more robust kind of understanding and defense of the Golden Rule. And so why don't we invite you first to tell us about his understanding of the Golden Rule and in what ways that's an improvement as a version on what we might call the everyday or literal understanding of the Golden Rule.
Yeah. So the first thing Gensler does really is he sort of acknowledges the defective desires criticism, if you will. And you really wouldn't want to live in a world where everyone treats each other as they want to be treated, because your neighbor probably has some desires that you find very unfavorable.
Mm.
And so he recognizes this. And so he sort of dispenses with this. He says, look, it's not about how I would, it's, how does he put it? It's about our present reaction to a hypothetical case. And I'm quoting here, it's about how we would react. It's not about how we would react if we were in the hypothetical case. So I like that, right? So he immediately acknowledges that defect of the Golden Rule. But then it's a little nuanced. And as a philosopher, I think, you know, I nuance is great.
Right.
As long as it's accurate, you know, we want some nuance. And so he says it's about our present reaction, and which that includes our attitudes, our beliefs, right, to a hypothetical case, right? So he has these clauses here. So there's a same situation clause. So there must be some sort of similarity of situation. And I think that's great too. And this captures part of the Golden Rule, treat others as you want to be treated, even though there's nothing in that directly mentions our reactions and our interactions with each other. There is this sort of other directedness to it. And so I think Gensler is getting at this when he says the same situation clause. But then he has the present attitude clause, and this is that nuance, I think. Given my present attitudes now, if I imagine myself in some other place in a similar situation as someone else, given my attitudes I hold now, then am I willing that that be done to me? And it sort of seems like a weird step, like, oh, it's just, you know, poppycock, or it's just this weird ad hoc kind of thing. but I think there's something to it, right? It's not me being the other person. It's me being me in a similar situation as the other person.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have to imagine myself as kind of like two people, you know, myself with my present beliefs. And Ginzer asks us to think about, you know, how my actions would affect somebody else. And I would have to know what my actions would have. And I'd have to vividly and accurately imagine myself as well in the place of someone else. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit of nuance here. And I think we can eschew some of the worries of the literal golden rule with this more sophisticated golden rule.
So it's not just treat others how you would want to be treated. But,
right.
But the question is, you know, the hypothetical for everybody who's not so familiar with this term. I mean, it's an everyday sense of language, but the way philosophers use it can be fairly technical. We mean something yes. like, if you were in a certain circumstance that you're not in presently, you know, think about these things happening to you, and then what would you want, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And so that's more nuanced.
A concrete hypothetical to kind of help us think through this.
Well, you know, it's the hypothetical since Kant and Professor Hurst and Ginzler and myself use it. So I'll use the judge criminal case, right?
Right.
So literal golden rule: treat others as you want to be treated. Well, clearly the judge wants to sentence the criminal. The criminal doesn't want to be sentenced. The criminal wouldn't sentence the judge because the criminal wouldn't want to be sentenced him or herself. And so the judge shouldn't sentence the criminal. That's nonsense.
That's a nice example, though, actually.
Yeah, no, it's always a good example.
Should the judge treat someone the way they want to be treated, right?
Yeah, right. The criminal definitely doesn't want to go to jail. All right,
exactly.
Good point.
So this is it's clearly like nonsense, right? And everyone recognizes that. So this is Ginzler's take then. The criminal should realize, right? Okay, I've done some bad things and I realize what the judge is saying. And from the judge's point of view, I really should be behind bars because I actually am a menace to society. And so even though I presently don't want to, if I put myself in the position of the judge, then clearly I ought to be in jail. And the other way around, right? The judge would say, well, as criminal, I wouldn't want to be sentenced, but as judge criminal, then clearly I realize that I should be put in jail. And so as the judge, then I can be secure in my judgment that they should be put in jail. Everyone's happy. Everyone goes to jail.
Well, this sounds good. I think I get it. That's good. Yeah,
and for what it's worth, we have a significant audience who are listening from federal prison in Lexington.
Oh, nice.
Hi, guys.
Yeah. And so shout out to you guys.
Yeah.
All right. So you even in your article, you suggest, well, this is also, it doesn't work either. Like it has certain points where it fails. So can you give us a short sort of, I think it's a pretty strong argument. So in short is, how does it fall apart or at least stumble?
So I think there's two things. So if I'll say one thing that's not in the article, I want to go back to what you said about children. So children have, I think, probably a really difficult time doing this, you know, because you have to ask them to think on, you know, so many levels. And it's not clear to me, like the children get the literal golden rule, like, oh yeah, I don't want that done to me, so I'm not going to do it. But adult life is way more complex than that. And asking children to consider what Ginzler calls the same situation clause, the present attitude clause, and a don't combine clause, I think is beyond anything sort of recognizable to a child. But I think where Ginzler suffers and where the golden rule suffers, also, Maxwell's version, the literal golden rule, is a conceptual flaw. And this is why I mentioned earlier, I said it sort of depends on how seriously we actually think we're taking the golden rule. So I have students all the time that say, oh yeah, they'll say, I live by the golden rule. Like, well, let's see if that's actually true. So here's the conceptual flaw. Ginzler and Maxwell both ask us to imagine ourselves in the place of someone else. And Ginzler says we need to do this vividly and accurately. And if we take accurately to mean, you know, what we normally do, you know, like actually factually true, and, you know, Maxwell says that we can just easily do this, then we have a problem. And this is why I used the example of being John Malkovich.
The movie being John Malkovich.
Yeah. The 90, what is it, 99 movie?
For listeners who haven't seen that, what is the sort of key point of that?
Yeah. So the main character, Craig, he's sort of, dissatisfied with life and so on. And he finds this door in an office, in his office, and he can go through it. And he finds when he goes through it, he ends up being, quote unquote, in the mind of John Malkovich.
It's a wild movie, guys.
It's an interesting movie, right? And so he sees what Malkovich sees and hears what he sees and so on and so forth. And to some degree can even control what Malkovich does and so on. And I think the same thing happens with that movie that happens with the Golden Rule. We sort of just let it go and we don't think about what's actually happening. The whole time anyone and other people end up going inside Malkovich's head. The whole time everyone who's in Malkovich's head knows that they're not Malkovich. They keep their own identity. They just, I guess, experience what Malkovich experiences. And mm-hmm. my criticism is that if we take it seriously, the vividly and accurately criteria, like if I really have to imagine myself in the place of someone else, then as I say in the article here, right, according to sort of traditional sort of metaphysical standards, if you have the exact experiences of someone else, then you are no longer yourself. You're that person. And if you do have their experiences, then how can you know that you're having an accurate experience? And so you lose any sense of identity and demarcation there. You can't have difference and sameness. And yet, in order to practice the Golden Rule, you have to have difference mm-hmm. from a technical standpoint. And so I think, all these traditional criticisms aside, if we're serious, right, and like Marriott is serious and Maxwell is serious and our students are serious, that I live the Golden Rule, if that involves imagining yourself in the place of someone else, then you actually aren't living the Golden Rule. And you have the weird consequence of practicing a morality that's based solely on individual preference.
Very interesting. So we've got to wrap up this segment, but would it be fair to characterize what you're saying essentially as, saying that, when we're trying to understand what it would be like in someone else's shoes in that situation, that basically we'll always be limited in our knowledge of how of what it would be like. Is that fair?
I think it's fair. I don't think it's entirely accurate, though.
Okay.
I would say impossible.
Oh, you would go even farther and say it's impossible.
Yeah. My claim in the article is that right. is that you can't.
Literally, it's impossible to conceive of yourself in someone else's position.
Yeah.
Because if you were to fully be in someone else's position, you'd be that person. And you wouldn't be aware of yourself. It's a fun identity problem. Okay.
And then if I may say very quickly, and then when the Golden Rule fails, we end up reverting to ordinary moral principles in the first place. The Golden Rule isn't much at all.
Doesn't help much, therefore.
Doesn't do anything.
Very interesting. Well, everybody, we want to know what you think about this. We're going to come back after a short break with one more segment with Dan Flores. This is Eric Weber. My co-host is Anthony Cashio, and you've been listening to Philosophy Bakes Bread. We'll be right back.
Welcome back, everyone. It's your privilege today to be listening to Philosophy Bakes Bread. This is Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber, and it's our privilege today to be talking with Daniel Flores about the Golden Rule, or the not-so-golden rule, as it were. In the second segment, we kind of looked at a critique of the everyday version of the Golden Rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. In the third segment, we kind of explored a more nuanced academic, if you want, version of the Golden Rule and critique that as well. In this last segment, we're going to end with some big picture questions. We're going to bake some bread, maybe to tell some wonderful jokes, and end with a question for everyone to think about as we go on our way. All right, Dan. So do you think your critique applies to certain variations of the Golden Rule? I mean, there's sort of, as you mentioned, throughout history, there's all these different versions of the Golden Rule. One I really like is sort of, I call it the negative Golden Rule, right? Don't do unto others as you would have them not do unto you. Or the one I teach my children actually is treat others as they would want to be treated. Kind of. So do you think the critique would actually apply to all these sort of variations of the Golden Rule, or do you just the sort of?
You'd have to see. So I think the negative version, right? You still have to sort of consider other people, and that's fine. But it seems to me that you would also have to be asked to vividly and accurately imagine yourself, so you'd have to know what they wouldn't want and so on. I think it's I think it's similar. Yeah. I mean, I don't see why not. And then, you know, I point this out in the article too, like, we want a version of the golden rule that's recognizable as the golden rule. And so when you start, say, the last thing you mentioned, like treating other people as they want to be treated, well, that's presumably not the golden rule.
Have I moved beyond?
That's like the platinum rule.
Let's call it the platinum rule. Let's upgrade it.
Yeah.
I actually like my version a lot more than the golden rule. I've considered it deeply. So.
Yeah. So the problem with the platinum rule, I mean, I think there's an obvious problem with the platinum rule.
Oh, no. Right?
So all right. Treat people as they want to be treated.
Mm-hmm.
So where's the problem?
The judge case.
Yeah.
Well, also the judge case, right? So what about what I want? Like, don't I as a moral agent have some, like, aren't I important? Like, do I not have some?
That's right. Points? If the other person wants to be treated as the king and you as a servant, right? Yeah. Why should I accept that?
Mother Teresa died unhappy.
Ah, whoa, okay. You know? Very interesting.
I'm just going to let that one hang there.
Presumably my moral life matters too.
Right, of course, okay.
So I'm not just going to treat other people as they want to be treated. That's moral in, you know, servitude.
Very interesting.
But anyway, I always thought I kind of took the sort of almost egoism out of the moral rule. So now I have to like basically maybe listen to the other person, talk to the other person, see kind of what they want to be called and how they want to be treated.
Be a responsible adult human being.
Yeah. Right. So this is one version, I think, of an application of Anthony's rule that makes a lot of sense, right? When, for instance, you're addressing someone, you know, some people want to be called by their first names and some people want to be called professor or doctor, right? Or, you know, so in a sense, one should consider a person's preferences when you kind of try to respect them as a person. But I do see that there's examples that are troubling, like the case in which someone wants you to be subservient.
Yeah. So
exactly.
Why can't we just have
perfect morals? So, I mean, you know, the thing we have to remember, right? I mean, we're not, you know, we don't want to try to be Kant necessarily and have sort of just this sort of universal morality. I mean, I think
I try not to be Kant myself.
I can't.
Right. Well, but, you know, but there's severe problems with you know, utilitarian principles also, right? I mean, we all are aware of the theoretical problems of utilitarianism, and yet utilitarianism in particular keeps coming back. I think it might have been Philippa Foot who referred to it as a weed. You just can't seem to get rid of it. And I think I think one thing the Golden Rule does is it really appeals to our sense of welfare.
Oh, that's interesting. I like that.
Yeah. So I make a lot about these ordinary moral principles, and, you know, they might be rooted in these conditions of welfare, you know, not necessarily like rights necessarily, but, you know, what does it mean to live a sort of a decent human life? And I think, you know, if there's a merit to the golden rule or to some of this stuff, it's just a point in that direction.
And this may be obvious to many listeners, but at least one or two out there may need the clarification that we're not talking about a government support. And when we say welfare, we mean people's well-being. Yeah. You know, it's just that's a word that these days is
something.
Right. Right? We mean people's well-being.
Right.
The well-being.
Right. To promote the general welfare is the language in the Constitution, right? Exactly. Right.
And presumably that's what political and government welfare stems from.
Is intended to be anyway, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Good.
Yeah.
So, okay, I've got a question for you, Dan. So, you know, isn't one of the important features of literature that it teaches us to see through others' eyes? You know, we read thoughts from others' perspectives, partly because doing so teaches us how others see the world, right? And so, you know, moral education is involved when you read things like To Kill a Mockingbird or The Bluest Eye and so forth, right? And so part of what that's doing is it's teaching you how to see how others, you know, feel, and that helps us be able to respect the golden rule, arguably.
And there's been some studies shown that so you can actually teach empathy through the teaching of literature.
Right. So are we misguided in kind of wanting to foster that sort of sentimental education to feel, you know, at least more proximally kind of the ways in which others feel, to try at least have a little bit more recognition of what that might be like?
Right. No, I don't think we're misguided in our desires to have, you know, a populace that is attuned to otherness and other people and cultures. And, you know, maybe we don't always need to be sensitive, but we do need to be aware, and we do need to be, in certain cases, accommodating.
Mm-hmm.
We're not the only, you know, I'm not the only one that inhabits this planet, and my culture and ethnic background, you know, is only a small part of what's out there. So I don't think we're misguided in that way. My problem comes when we start making these claims that, you know, you don't need anything else other than the golden rule. And someone like Maxwell even goes so far as to say, you know, he says, theologians, philosophers, lawyers, educators have all made ethics way more difficult. All you need is the golden rule. You know, I got to raise my hand and call that out. Mm. And this is sort of the motivation, right? Is yes, the literature, we need that. The literature, you know, we can learn to be empathetic and sympathetic, at least sympathetic. And it does teach us and it enculturates us. And I think it gives us a broader perspective. And if humanity is going to survive, it's going to survive because we realize that we're all in the same sort of situation here, and we're going to have to survive together. Mm-hmm. So I think that's great. I just don't like when someone says, oh no, it's really simple. Just live by the golden rule. What can be easier than that? And even Gensler, for example, it just, he's asking you to do, when he says vividly and accurately, then it's no, false. Like, no,
it's impossible. Can't.
So, right. So let's focus. Yeah. Let's focus on what we should be focusing on, ordinary moral principles, and let's have a discussion about that and how do ordinary moral principles play a role in our lives and what can we do to enculturate ourselves, not just in our own ordinary moral principles, but those of other people.
Very interesting.
I like it. That's good. All right. So right, it seems concentrating on the golden rule is the only way then keeps us from actually looking to literature as we expand, so we can actually teach ourselves as we go.
Yeah, we could, but again, just we got to keep it in check.
Exactly. So,
I mean, we have to understand what we're using the golden rule for.
You say you're not a pragmatist. All right. Well, speaking of what things are for, I like, this is a good segue right here.
Nice.
You know, yeah. One of our final questions comes from the inspiration for our show. I think you've maybe answered a little bit already, but we can get into it here. Dan, do you think that philosophy bakes bread or not? Which is to say, do you think it's got practical import to our lives? And if so, how so? If not, why not?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Resounding yes. I wouldn't do this if it were just some futile exercise in intellectuality or something.
Nice.
Of course it bakes bread, and it's baked bread in my life, right? Not only, you know, do I have a, you know, a nice place to live and, you know, a nice ride to drive, I pay my bills and so on, you know, doing philosophy, but as I mentioned in the earlier part of the show, you know, philosophy's helped me, you know, helped me to sort of live better. Not, you know, not necessarily, I'm not, you know, necessarily like the best person in the world. I think that's, I don't know what I feel about that, but it certainly helped me live in the world. It's cleared up questions. It's answered questions. It doesn't bake bread in, as my former teacher used to say, it doesn't make better barbecue grills or car seat warmers or things like that necessarily. It doesn't have the immediate sort of bread baking qualities that you would ask for. But I think on a much deeper level, it bakes loaves of bread.
Nice.
Yeah. So I think philosophy is really good at clearing things up and showing what is irrelevant. And if we only have a mind to listen to it, and I'm thinking here our leaders, political leaders, administrators, business type leaders, you know, CEOs, managers. I think if we have a mind to truth and falsity, a mind to actually trying to get things right, not just believing we're trying to get things right, then philosophy is you can't do without it.
Nice. Well, fantastic. That's I love that answer. And that's now, great. As you know, Dan, we want people to see both the serious side of philosophy as well as the lighter side. So we have a bit in this last segment that we call Philosophunnies.
Say Philosophunnies.
Philosophunnies.
Say Philosophunnies.
Philosophunnies.
So we'd love to hear got a favorite joke or funniest fact about philosophy, something that's related to what we've been talking about, or just, you know, just a funny joke or something. Have you got a funny joke or a story to tell us?
Yeah. How about two sort of quick philosophy
jokes? That's how we like them.
So here's my favorite one. How do you get a philosopher off your front porch?
I don't know how.
Pay for the pizza.
Oh, ouch. Ooh, I gotta get that dagger out of my back.
Dim prospect for philosophy. Okay, so how about this one? Knock knock.
Who's there?
philosopher.
Philosopher who?
Exactly.
Ouch. Oh, man. I'm hurting.
That's going in my new repertoire. I like that one.
That one hurts a lot. So Anthony and I always gather a couple of jokes, and we try to make them about the subject matter of the day, and I think we succeeded this time. Anthony, you want to give the first one?
No, you get the first one. I'll get the last one.
All right, right. Okay, so here it is. The golden rule is that the boss's jokes are always funny. No, we did get a laugh, wow. Actually. A little bit.
The golden rule for marriage. One, your spouse is always right. Two, when you feel they are wrong, read number one again.
All right. You know, and this actually relates closely to your article, Dan. The golden rule forgot to account for masochists. Oh, man.
I was going to say, are we being serious here?
That was supposed to be a joke, but actually I think that came up in your article as a real point.
It's a real
point. And a masochist, of course, is someone who enjoys pain. So if you're treating – anyway, philosophers explaining jokes.
There you go.
Philosophy can be very funny.
It can be. That's right. Not that we succeed, but we try.
What is the golden rule for cows?
I don't know. What is it?
Do unto others as you would have others do unto you.
Jeez.
Oh, man.
Nice. Oh, we didn't deserve that rim shot, I think. Maybe.
Oh, no, that is my favorite joke we've ever told on here.
Do you want to utters? Oh, boy.
Oh, no, I just reading it makes me cool. All right, well, great. Our last segment of the show, right before we wrap it up, is a segment called You Tell Me. And so we want to take advantage of, you know, today we live in a world where we're connected with a lot of people and we can have two-way communications, even for programs like our radio show. So we want to invite the listeners to send us their thoughts about big questions we've raised on the show.
That's right, Dan. So we'd love to hear if you've got a question to pose with our listeners for the segments we call You Tell Me. Have you got a question for them?
Yeah. All right. So my motivation recently has been thinking about, you know, philosophers are really good about writing for each other and talking to each other and so on. And we haven't historically done a really good job about engaging the public. And so given the, you know, 21st century, you know, fake news, alternative facts kind of attitudes. My question is for the audience, what role do they think, particularly philosophers, more generally, just sort of educated people should play in our society?
Hmm.
You go to other countries and it seems that this isn't a very, like, it would be an odd question, but in the United States, we have sort of a negative attitude toward intelligence and so on. And I know I get criticized a lot for having, you know, well thought out ideas as if that's some sort of criticism.
You and your well thought.
And so, yeah, that's my question. And so if you say no, then I would personally like to know why. What is it about having public intellectuals that's so scary or we think is wrong? And if you think yes, then of course, similarly, I'd like to know why.
And just to, can I ask you to repeat the question one time? Because I didn't realize it was a yes or no question. I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, you know, there's varying answers. So do you think that philosophers in particular or public intellectuals more generally should have more or less place in the public sphere? And if you say yes or no, I would really like to know why. What's right or what's wrong with having public intellectuals in the public sphere?
Nice. Great question.
If you're listening to this, I'm really curious about the answer, especially if it's no.
Right.
Well, thank you, everyone, for listening to Philosophy Bakes Bread. Your hosts today have been Anthony Cashio and Eric Weber, and we're really grateful to have been joined by Dan Flores. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.
It's been a pleasure.
It really has. Awesome. It's been a really great pleasure. And we hope you listeners will join us again. Consider sending us your thoughts about anything you've heard today that you'd like to hear about in the future or about the specific questions we've raised for you today, especially the one that Dan just raised, right? What role do you think philosophers should or could play in our society and the public?
That's right. So everybody, catch us on Twitter, Facebook, and on our website at philosophybakesbread.com, where we've got transcripts, thanks to Drake Bowling. And thanks also, by the way, to Stephen Barrera, both of them students at the University of Kentucky. Thanks, Stephen and Drake.
Stephen, Drake, you guys are the best. Thanks.
Also, thank you. Yeah. Also, everyone, if you want to support the show and to be more involved in the work of the Society of Philosophers in America, SOFIA, head to philosophersinamerica.com and consider joining the society.
And if you're enjoying this show, and we hope you are, maybe take a quick second to rate and review us on iTunes, your podcast app, wherever you're finding us today. Good reviews, if you're giving us one, help us reach more people and bake some more bread, and we would really appreciate it. And of course, you can always email us at philosophybakesbread, that's all one word, philosophybakesbread@gmail.com. And you can also call us and leave a short recorded message with a question or a comment that we may be able to play on the show. And you can reach us at 859-257-1849. That's 859-257-1849. Join us again next time on Philosophy Bakes Bread, food for thought about life and leadership.
If you're enjoying this podcast from WRFL Lexington, you may enjoy our live radio stream at WRFL.fm and, of course, via radio at 88.1 FM in the Central Kentucky area. We have a wide variety of programs you're sure to enjoy. Just go to WRFL.fm/schedule and see what programs appeal most to you. Thanks again for listening to this podcast from WRFL Lexington.